It's time for questions and minister statements, and I will call Mr. Mulholland.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is to the Minister for Regional Development. Minister, on 21st of June 2023, here in this Parliament, as part of your responsibilities as Minister for Regional Development, you boasted, and I quote, around about $3 billion return on investment, and we also know the commitments that we have made will deliver around 7,500 jobs. When did you become aware of the cost blowouts and ultimately the government's decision to cancel the 2026 Commonwealth Games that will now impact the $3 billion return on investment?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Mulholland, for your unique, albeit somewhat metropolitan, lens of the regional delivery of the Commonwealth Games. I'll take that up, Ms. Crozier. Since before I was pre-selected, since when I grew up, since when I've represented the area I've lived in regional Victoria, Ms. Crozier, so I look forward to that particular line of conjecture ending from here. Mr. Mulholland, as you would be aware, the detail of the announcement to move to a multi-host city is something which was part of discussions between the government and my predecessor in the role and the Minister for Commonwealth Games Delivery. The key reason for the bid going up and being successful was to be able to deliver an enormous range of benefits to regional Victoria, and part of that, as you've indicated, was the delivery of thousands of jobs. This was also, as I've indicated to this place on numerous occasions, about making sure that we could get a return on our investment, that we could see that investment at the funds which was allocated in the 2022-23 budget of $2.6 billion be realised through a return of around $3 billion, and that this would leave lasting legacy of infrastructure and benefit to rural and regional communities. What has happened since the 18th of July and that decision as announced by the Premier, the Deputy Premier and I not to proceed with the Commonwealth Games is that we are moving towards the delivery sooner of that regional legacy, which is a $2 billion package. That is about making sure, that we can provide $1 billion in additional funding for rural and regional social and affordable housing, which adds to the $1.25 billion already part of the regional housing build. It's also...
Mr. Mulholland, a point of order.
Point of order. I'd ask you to bring the Minister to the question. I asked when did the Minister become aware of the cost blowouts and ultimately the government's decision to cancel the Commonwealth Games?
I thought there was two questions that you posed in your questions. So, and I believe the Minister was addressing one of those questions.
No.
So, if you look, I'm happy for the. Yeah.
Well, you get to answer the question.
No, I'm happy. I'm happy to review it after question time, but my understanding is there was two questions and the Minister's chosen one, which is her right. Ms. Crozier, on a point of order.
Point of order, if I can possibly assist, President. The question was, when did you become aware of cost blowouts and ultimately the government's decision to cancel the 2026 Commonwealth Games that will now impact the $3 billion return on investment? It's very simple. One question.
I'll call the Minister to continue her response and I'll consider the point of order.
You can't help yourself, can you, Ms. Crozier? I just want to answer the question. So what we are doing, Mr. Mulholland, is providing that fund of $2 billion. Not only does that deliver a huge range of benefits to rural and regional communities, and those communities are, as I see every day when I'm out visiting with them and talking to them, a significant range of social and of economic benefits. There will be jobs created as part of that too. When you are putting an additional 1,300 social and affordable homes into the market, Those homes are built by people. Those homes are created by people, including apprentices and trainees. That permanent sporting infrastructure of $550 million, that's actually created by sparkies, by plumbers, by chippies. This is the sort of work that delivers lasting benefit and contributes to the record low unemployment rate in regional Victoria.
Mr. Mulholland, supplementary.
On a supplementary to the Minister, the Premier recently said of the decision to cancel the Commonwealth Games, the decision was weeks in the making after I was made aware of the cost blowout. When boasting of a return on investment in your regional development spend on the 21st of June in this chamber, were you misleading the Parliament, incompetent or simply out of the loop?
There was three questions in that. Minister?
See, Mr. Mulholland, you can't help yourself, can you? Whoever is drafting your questions needs to learn the art of perhaps asking one rather than three questions in a substantive or in a supplementary question. As the Premier, the Deputy Premier and I indicated really clearly on the 18th of July when the decision not to proceed with the Commonwealth Games was announced, it was really clear from those answers, and I've spoken about it at length in the Chamber and in communities, that the cost of putting on a 12-day event of more than $6 billion didn't stack up for regional communities. That was a decision that was taken after every option available to us was examined. And that was part of ongoing work in order to exhaust every single opportunity to deliver these games to rural and regional Victorian communities, because the objectives were always to make sure that we returned a huge level of enthusiasm, of visitation and of growth and prosperity and opportunity to regional Victoria. That's exactly what we're doing with the $2 billion regional package, Mr. Mulholland.
Sorry.
Point of order. Point of order.
Minister Shing, on a point of order.
Can I ask Mr. Davis to withdraw that, please? And don't say it on the record, Mr. Davis.
Mr. Davis, do you want to respond?
President, I withdraw.
Thank you. Ms. Fussell.
My question is for the Minister for Agriculture. Recently, Australian states and territories signed up to the new poultry standards. It stated that egg producers would have to phase out the use of conventional layer hen cages by 2036 at the latest. The final timeframe will be set by individual states and territories, and Western Australia has since pledged to act sooner than this. We have been talking about banning caged eggs for decades in Australia, and it has been 8 years since the regulatory process began. Australia's biggest food retailers, Woolworths and Coles, have already pledged to be 100% cage-free by 2025. Will the Minister commit to bringing the phase-out of battery cages forward across the whole of Victoria?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I thank the member for her question, and she is quite correct in noting that agriculture ministers met in July and we dealt with the new poultry welfare standards and guidelines. And she's also correct in indicating that the benchmark is 2036 and that the implementation is to be determined by individual states. Victoria will consider issues raised by industry and other stakeholders. We will be developing an implementation plan, and we will also be working on to implement the standards into our new animal welfare regulations that the member is well acquainted of doing. So the department has been active, very active with the industry leading up to that July meeting, and as a consequence that consultation has built up somewhat since as well in terms of talking with the industry about what the implementation plan might look like. I'm absolutely aware, as industry players, very much aware of what the market is doing and what the big supermarkets are doing and what they have publicly stated. And so it is going to be sort of interesting as to exactly what the timing will be here in Victoria, but also obviously having an eye to what the other jurisdictions are doing.
Ms. Purcell, supplementary.
President, and thank you, Minister. On top of battery cages, there are other animal welfare concerns across the whole egg industry, yet the code of practice is only voluntary. As you stated in your response, the government is introducing a long-awaited new animal care and protection bill, including new regulations for the egg industry. Will these regulations in the new Animal Care and Protection Act be mandatory instead of voluntary?
Minister.
President, thank you, and I thank the member for her ongoing interest in all things animals. Part of our discussions leading into the exposure draft is about making sure that we try and come up with a workable arrangement whereby the animal welfare rights are absolutely acknowledged, and indeed the animal production arrangements are also balanced. This has always been a point of tension. You know that, you live it. And of course, that is going to be shining through in terms of the consultations that we go through, in terms of the exposure draft. In terms of the voluntary versus mandatory, again, that's very much part of the discussions that we'll be having with the community.
Minister Symes, Minister's statement.
And I would like to update the House today on the government's delivery of new fire trucks for CFA brigades, which is always great, but particularly important ahead of this upcoming fire season. I'm getting to that, Ms Crozier. Last Wednesday, I had the pleasure of visiting Buninyong Fire Station with our three Ballarat-based regional MPs from the other place to hand over eight new heavy tankers to brigades across CFA District 15. This would be a record for me to hand over so many vehicles at the same time, and it was quite an impressive sight because they were all lined up at the station when I arrived. So impressive, gleaming trucks ready to be utilised if required by our CFA crews across the Ballarat region. The trucks were proudly adorned by the names of the brigades: Bulan, Buninyong, Mount Helen, Creswick, Dalesford, Miners Ridge, Napoleons and Windaree. The heavy tankers feature a 4,000 litre water tank with front-controlled water cannon. They can be operated from inside the cabin, and improved burnover protection to ensure our firefighters are kept safe while they're out protecting the community. I also got to view the new ultra-heavy tanker that will be based at Ballarat City Fire Brigade. It's one of a fleet of 29 of these new vehicles that have been deployed to brigades across the state. They are extraordinary vehicles. They can carry 10,000 litres of water, and they significantly boost firefighting capacity for those areas, and are particularly useful for grassland areas because they enable you to put a lot of wet stuff on a lot of the areas that grassland fires do often involve. Handing over new state-of-the-art equipment is an honour, but more importantly, it gives me another opportunity to visit, thank and acknowledge our brilliant volunteers, and I particularly thank all of the brigade members that turned out, particularly Buninyong, for hosting the event.
Mr. Borman with a question, please.
Cool. Thank you. Thank you, President. President, my question is for the Minister representing the Minister for Education. Minister, local primary schools in Druin and Warrigal are bursting at the seams, with more and more portable buildings taking up more and more of the playground to accommodate the massive growth in the area. The Catholic sector has stepped up and built new schools, but the state government has not. Can the Minister advise what new primary schools are funded for Druin and Warrigal?
Minister.
President, thank Mr. Borman for his question. I'll be very happy to refer that to the Minister for Education, who will provide you with an answer in accordance with the standing orders.
Mr. Borman, supplementary.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Minister, and thank you, Ms. Shing. Minister, the $380 million that your government just spent not hosting the Commonwealth Games in regional Victoria could easily have built 20 new primary schools in regional Victoria. Can the Minister advise why the decision was made to spend the money on not hosting a sporting event rather than investing in Victorians of the future?
Do you mind doing that again, Mr. Borman?
It'll come out the same.
All right. You make my life so easy. It's So I think Mr. Borman's happy to stand on his substantive. Dr. Bach.
Thanks, President. My question today is for the Minister for Youth Justice. Minister, on Monday evening, as you know, there was a serious assault of a staff member at the new Cherry Creek facility. You were warned that relocating the highest risk detainees to the new facility was dangerous due to a lack of staff experience at Cherry Creek. Considering of the first 10 inmates, I'm advised a significant proportion are on remand for allegedly committing murder, and given there has already been a serious assault, can you guarantee the safety of staff who are employed at Cherry Creek?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Dr. Bach for his interest in my youth justice portfolio and his question in relation to an important matter regarding our new flagship Cherry Creek facility. Let me say from the outset that the safety of everyone in our youth justice system is paramount. And I reject the premise of his question about the safety and training of the staff. Our new youth justice system approach is about a higher level of actually training and preparation. And many of the people that work at Cherry Creek, I've been out to Cherry Creek, actually have a range of experiences, not only across our youth justice system, but many of the experts we've hired have worked with young people in different environments. So I reject that premise. And I noticed that premise was also put to the newspaper by the Shadow Minister. And I wouldn't take everything that the Shadow Minister says on face value after his performance this weekend. Thank you.
Dr. Bach, supplementary? Dr. Bach, supplementary? Dr. Bach, supplementary?
Apologies, President, I hadn't heard you. Thank you, President, and I do thank the Minister. Minister, given the lengthy delay in opening Cherry Creek, isn't it a fact that facility simply wasn't ready for high-risk detainees?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank Dr. Bach for his supplementary. Again, I reject the premise of that question, and so the answer is no. I mean, what I've said from the outset, that this is a sensible and managed transition over several months. The staff work proactively to manage different situations, and where there is conduct that is alleged criminal behaviour, it's my expectation that's referred to Victoria Police, as I understand this matter has been. Thank you.
Minister Sheen, Minister's statement.
Thank you very much, President. Last Friday, I, along with so many other people in this chamber, across the Parliament and indeed around Australia and the world, celebrated Wear It Purple Day. This is an initiative which is intended to provide a measure of visible support, encouragement, care and love and respect to LGBTIQ plus young people who are, as we all know, as is irrefutably the case, at greater vulnerability to self-harm, to challenges to mental health and well-being, and to suicide. So, I celebrated Wear It Purple Day in Trafalgar on Friday with the incredible team at the Gippsland Pride Initiative and helped to open Gippsland's very first Pride Hub, which is an amazing community space being developed and now served by Uniting Care, the West Gippsland Health Service and Thorn Harbour Health, along with support from the state government. This is a welcoming, inclusive really warm space, and providing that care is so important. Within 30 minutes of opening, they in fact had a community member come in asking for resources and for support. So everywhere at Purple Day is an opportunity for us to recommit to being supportive and to being visible and to making sure that we are calling out any challenge to the safety, the dignity or the well-being of LGBTIQ plus young people. And in rural and regional Victoria, we know that this carries a special significance. As Minister for Water, it was also a joy to celebrate the exceptionally progressive sector which does encourage and welcome LGBTIQ plus people within our customer base, within workforce and within the community. I was delighted to catch up with Jo Lim, the CEO of Vic Water, with the DCAR Pride Network members, with Melbourne Water's Refract Committee, and in Shepparton I got to spend time with Golden Murray Water, Golden Valley Water and Golden Broken Catchment Management Authority to hear all about the work that they are doing within their diverse and exceptionally welcoming members of the workforce who identify as LGBTIQ+.
Dr. Bach with a question, please.
Thank you, President. President, I've got another question for the Minister for Youth Justice. Minister, as you say, your department is currently relocating detainees from Malmesbury to the new Cherry Creek Detention Centre. The first 10 are extremely high-risk young people. Why have they been moved to lower-level security settings at Cherry Creek, resulting in a staff member being injured at work?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and thank Dr. Bark for his question in relation to our new flagship Cherry Creek facility. Again, I think some of your assertions, Dr. Bark, I hope you didn't receive them from the Shadow Minister, because some of his assertions I wouldn't accept on face value. I'll repeat that, because the model at Cherry Creek, you've asserted that it's less secure, I think that was the question or the assertion that you've made, or something along those lines. But I've been very clear in this chamber many times that the initial cohort at Cherry Creek is the 15 to 18 year old boys, which is a more complex cohort, but the Cherry Creek model is a different model. It's about giving young people the best chance to turn their lives around. Let me be clear. It's about giving them the best chance to turn their lives around. If they don't take that opportunity, that's up to them. But it is still a high security facility. It has the latest technology in place. The staff training model is higher than it's been before. Thank you.
Dr. Bark, supplement.
Thanks, President. I do thank the Minister. Minister, there was an agreement for 30% of staff to be experienced and 70% new trained at Cherry Creek. At this point in time, I'm advised the experience level is as low as 5%, clearly putting staff at risk. So I ask, how many more convicted murderers or those on remand for allegedly committing murder will be relocated to Cherry Creek while there are insufficient experienced staff?
Minister.
President, I thank Dr. Bark for his supplementary question. In relation to the level of offending, I've already addressed that in my substantive. I've said it's a high-risk cohort with children with complex behavioural issues, and that's why they're at this new facility where we're giving them a chance to turn their lives around. It'd be very inappropriate to comment, considering the small numbers of young people, many of them are alleged, let's be clear on that as well, to go into the specifics of who's there, because these are very detailed operational matters that I'll leave to the experts instead of the conspiracy theorists.
Mr. Limbrick.
The guy in hospital.
Mr. Limbrick, got a question, please.
Thank you, President. Thank you, President. My question is for the Attorney General. Yesterday during committee stage, the Attorney said something that piqued my interest around apparently there's some mysterious people, I don't know who they are, who look at bills to repeal. And I'm very interested in that, because I haven't seen many bills to repeal things lately. So I would be interested if the Attorney could provide an update to the House on what work is being done on repealing old, outdated, or as we saw yesterday, even sometimes potentially dangerous bill acts.
Minister.
Thank you, President. And not necessarily in my capacity as Attorney General, but probably as Chair of the Legislation Committee, would probably be more appropriate for me to answer in that capacity. So all departments that identify bills that have room for minor changes are fed into a process and collated for a statute amendment bill. We often have probably one a term, which is the opportunity to identify any minor errors, such as missing semicolons, or effectively we call it the crossing the T, dotting the I bills regularly. It's also the opportunity to identify whether there could be small repealing of bills as well. I will soon bring to this Parliament a repeal bill in relation to legislation that I've identified will no longer be required, so I look forward to briefing you in relation to that. When it comes to bills such as what you've identified that really are not causing any errors, they're not being applicable, a tidy up is necessary, but it's not an urgent priority of the government to identify defunct legislation that is not causing any issues.
Mr. Limbrick, supplementary.
Thank you, President. I thank the attorney for that, and I look forward to seeing this repeal bill. In the last term of Parliament, a number of crossbenchers spoke with the then Leader of the Upper House, Mr. Jennings, And the idea was discussed, this was before everything was hijacked by the pandemic, of a repeal day, identifying a large number of these outdated bits, outdated acts. And there seemed to be much support for amongst the crossbench and even the government, I might say, to have such an omnibus bill and call it a repeal day. Would the attorney be interested in putting forward something like this in this term of parliament?
Minister.
Yeah, I should have seen that one coming. What I will commit to is I'll bring that topic to LegCo because Minister Jennings was the former chair of that committee, and such a proposal would come to that committee, and I'll put it on the agenda for a discussion with the members of that committee and report back to you.
We need a parliament.
I am now going to call Minister Blandford with a Minister's statement.
Thank you, President. I rise to update the House on the vital work child protection practitioners do every day to keep children and young people safe and families strong. Recently, I was pleased to visit a child protection intake office in the northern suburbs to chat to child protection practitioners who receive reports at the intake phase of child protection. These workers receive thousands of reports every year, ranging from concerned friends and neighbours through to mandatory reports from schools, from police, from health settings regarding the safety of children and young people. Reports are received in multiple ways, with the most common being through our intake phone lines. The role that these workers play in the child protection system cannot be overstated. They use their professional judgment to make difficult decisions on the action that should be taken in response to these reports each and every day. Their ability to investigate the report and gather facts to inform their decision making is critical. I want to thank each of these practitioners and the staff that I visited with for the insights that they shared in relation to their roles. The difference they are making every day in response to the reports received is astounding. They make incredibly tough decisions, but they are making an important difference in each family, each and every day. I appreciated the opportunity to thank them directly for their work. President, it's this side of the House that will always back this vital workforce and support the job that they do, and it's why we promote a career in child protection through our Go Where You're Needed and Jobs That Matter campaigns. And we provide them with the resources they need, 1,180 additional child protection practitioners that have been funded since we came to government. With National Child Protection Week starting this Sunday, I take the opportunity to thank all child protection practitioners and the workforce in our community sector organisation partners for the invaluable service that they all make to keeping Victorian children and young people safe and families strong. They all embody the theme for this year's National Child Protection Week: every child in every community needs a fair go.
Mrs. MacArthur, with a question, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is for the Minister for Agriculture and concerns the recent behaviour of power company AusNet, which this month entered without permission multiple farm properties on the transmission line between Ballarat and Bendigo. Minister, as you know, AusNet has the right to work in existing easements, but to do so must enter and cross private property in agricultural use. In this case, no notification was given and no permission was granted. This wasn't just unlawful, and it's not just about the potential for physical damage to soil and crops. There is a real danger pests or disease could have been introduced to animals and crops. As the Minister responsible for Victoria's biosecurity, what have you done to protect farmers' livelihoods from this outrageous and potentially disastrous trespass?
What I'm struggling is that the Minister's not responsible for AusNet. I would think that would be the Minister for Energy.
It's agriculture use, yeah. Land use.
But look, Ms. MacArthur.
Point of order to clarify, President. The Minister is responsible for biosecurity and she is responsible for the protection of farmers in her agricultural portfolio.
Look, I'm happy for the Minister to respond.
Thank you, President, and I thank Mrs. MacArthur for her question. In terms of the technicalities, They are the responsibility Minister D'Ambrosio. But in terms of the point you raise in terms of biosecurity, can I suggest that you provide me with the exact details that you have, and I'll take that on board in terms of further investigation in respect to biosecurity issues, if they have occurred.
Mr. McArthur, supplementary question.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Minister. We'll be able to provide you with detailed photographic evidence of the trespass, absolutely, and the impending consequences. But these regrettable incidents occurred when many farmers, they're your responsibility, Minister, farmers, were here in Spring Street protesting alongside their whole community against the damage the Western Renewables Link and the VNI West will do to agriculture in this state, Minister. Many believe it was cynically timed to exploit their absence. This behaviour happened on easements which have existed for decades and where the power company should have a long-standing relationship with the landholder. Again, your responsibility, Minister. So, Minister, even the most immediate stage of AEMO's grid development plan in Victoria includes another 650 kilometres of transmission lines. So we really need to know that what you're going to do to protect farmers from this blight so that you can continue to have productive agricultural land in this state.
There was a lot of that question. I have no doubt in the minister's that she's a very capable minister, but with her responsibility under the executive orders, and I'm not even going to put that question. I just think it's a the answer to the substantive question was that is not my responsibility, but I'm happy to go out of my way and give some extra information outside the standing orders. I believe that's the way I'd terminate, and then. Then we have a question about new transmission networks, which is clearly not this minister's responsibility under the executive orders. Ms. Crozier, you've got a point of order.
Thank you, President, and I've just listened to your ruling then. But clearly, as Mrs. McArthur has pointed out, this is about agricultural land use and the biosecurity aspects. And when farmers who own that land were down here in Spring Street, this occurred, these events occurred. So there is a direct linkage from the supplementary to the substantive. And I would ask you to ask the Minister to come back to that very important question Mrs. McArthur has put, because those farmers deserve to understand what the government's response is.
The supplementary may have been relevant to the substantive question. The substantive question wasn't a question under responsibility of this minister. I'll go to the next question. Dr. Barks. Ms. Barr.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Agriculture. The destructive bee parasite, Varroa mite, was detected 6 days ago at Euston, with 30,000 hives being held in the emergency eradication zone awaiting destruction, and over 100,000 hives which cannot be moved in the surveillance emergency zone. As pollination of the almond orchards has concluded, these bees are now starving and bee health is deteriorating. Minister, with almost a week passed since Varroa mite was detected on our border, when will beekeepers in the northern Victorian area be provided with urgently needed food and hive miticide strips to avoid a widespread outbreak in Victoria?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I thank the member for raising this issue today. This is an issue that has been taking a lot of time and resources in relation to Agriculture Victoria. It's a complex area and it is very heavily reliant on expert guarded advice. and we have got, fortunately, some very highly skilled scientific staff at Agriculture Victoria that provide exceptional advice. I can give the member the latest update in relation to the varroa mite disease. On the 29th of August, the National Expert Technical Committee, which guides the varroa response plan, met and agreed that moving hives out of the current surveillance zones, which is the outer area of the emergency zone within the almond growing regions near the Murray, was a safe measure consistent with the national response plan. This means that hives will be moving away from concentrations currently in the Sunraysia region on both sides of the border. The expert advice is that this will reduce the consequences of the current varroa outbreak in New South Wales and reduce the risk of it spreading to Victoria. Agriculture Victoria is putting robust measures in place to ensure that this is done as safely as possible. A permit system to facilitate movement from the surveillance zone with increased biosecurity requirements has been established. This stipulates the strict testing and reporting requirements and follow-up surveillance and testing after hives have been moved. To coordinate this response, Agriculture Victoria has deployed staff into the State Biosecurity Coordination Centre and a forward command post, which is supporting on-ground work by the State Quarantine Response Team, which consists of Agriculture Victoria staff and industry and recreational beekeepers. This is essentially the situation as we know it at the moment. It is moving quite fast, and of course all of the states are in communication 24/7, but it was the meeting that was held on the 29th that has placed these new arrangements so that we can deal with the current situation, President.
Ms. Martha, supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Minister for your response. The varroa mite certainly came to Australia over 14 months ago, we know into New South Wales ports, and it has been detected, as you rightly say, and I've discussed, on our Victorian border. You've spoken about the national plan, but farmers in that region are very concerned that there is no specific Victorian varroa mite action plan, and I therefore ask you, why haven't you, in that 14-month period, actually established a Victorian action plan to protect the livelihoods of the beekeepers and the crops they pollinate?
Minister.
Taking you through exactly what's happening, I can go into further detail, but clearly from your question, I would suggest that, and I'll put out the offer, that you get a departmental brief.
Minister Stitt, with a Minister Business question.
President, I'd like to update the House on how the Andrews Labor government is securing the future of Hanging Rock with the purchase of Hanging Rock's East Paddock and the release of a new master plan for this culturally significant and wildly cherished landscape. I was very proud to join the member for Macedon in the other place, representatives from Macedon Rangers Shire Council, members of the local community and representatives from three traditional owner groups, the Jarjar Warang Clans Aboriginal Corporation, Tunnerong Land and Water Council and the Wurundjeri Woi Wurrung Cultural Heritage Aboriginal Corporation on country at Hanging Rock, to announce that the newly acquired East Paddock will be officially integrated into the Hanging Rock Reserve. Hanging Rock is an incredibly popular tourist destination with more than 120,000 visitors a year, and a number that is expected to double over the next decade. The new master plan outlines carefully considered actions that will benefit the site and ensure that increasing visitor numbers don't negatively impact this special place. The master plan acknowledges and celebrates traditional owners' enduring relationship with the land and nature, and provides for traditional owner expertise in managing tourism
and cultural education experiences. With environmental sustainability and ecological integrity at its heart, the plan also recommends regenerating areas within the precinct. And the purchase of the East Paddock brings into the precinct's boundary, and it will continue to cater for a range of temporary uses, such as special music events and that contribute to the economy and the culture of the Macedon Rangers. I'd like to thank everybody who's been involved in development of the master plan over the past 2 years. It's an enormous amount of work to develop an agreed roadmap for the future management of this iconic site.
Thank you. That ends questions and minister's statements.